I'm delighted to introduce the moderator for the session, Temi Odomusu, who is going to provide a case study. And we are hoping the case study is quite short and sharp in a sense, in order to allow some discussion around it.
Hi everybody, I'm Temi. Okay, can you hear me now? Oh no, it's going to take 2 seconds and then my voice will come in. Yeah? Okay, cool. So, my name is Temi Odomusu. I come here via many different journeys. I was born and raised in London from two Nigerian immigrant parents, and I now find myself living in Copenhagen and working in Malmö in Sweden. So this is the contemporary condition. I actually prepared a case study that would last an hour. But of course we can weave in and out, because my intention is really to return to some basics about, at least in my reality, what decolonizing means in practice. And so to do this, I have kind of gathered some thoughts, some words, some sounds, and some artworks created by fellow sistren in the diaspora, to try to express what I think presence and care and agency means in this moment. And one of the reasons why I've been thinking about this is, A, because I exist in Scandinavia out of context, and that has come with pleasures, but also with challenges. It can be quite painful to live out of context and over a sustained amount of time. And also because recently I am in the middle of an artistic residency, amongst many things, at Botkyrka Konsthall. And they have a residence apartment in Fittja in Stockholm, which is one of these suburbs that everybody keeps talking about. And I thought about what I could do as somebody who was a kind of vessel of knowledge, as an art historian, as someone who has spent some time interrogating images. How could I participate in the conversation taking place in this environment without faking engagement, which was not really there? You can't enter a community and drop in and expect to make relationships. That takes time. So I thought I would literally just be there, be myself, do everything it takes to be me every day, and my own rituals, my own activities, and also project through my kitchen window some images, some sounds, some images and words to just get people thinking. And when I did this, I did this silently, just with the presentation rolling in the window, and then I had an event where I opened the door and allowed people to come in and ask questions and talk to me. And during this event, a friend of mine, Gaylene Gould, from the UK, an amazing woman, she was there. And after the event has finished, she sort of asked me, she said, "This is so interesting." She took this picture, watching the representations I was sharing, but also watching me being myself out of context. And so she asked me what it meant, how I felt about being in the environment, which is a question nobody really asks me in much detail, how it felt to be in Scandinavia, although, thanks, the questions have been coming. How it felt to be out of context in this environment with my own body. But also she asked me, wouldn't it be interesting to find out whether your body is signifying in a way that makes it difficult or easier, or what is happening in this relationship between your body and the bodies of the individuals that you speak about on a regular basis, and the images that you show. Is there something happening in this dynamic that's very particular because my body is in this space, that is altering, that is shifting, that is also challenging how people come to engage with these artifacts? And also images like this. This is also another woman, Dido Elizabeth Bell. She's given this overinflated classical name that was the style in the 18th century for African people. She's kind of in and out of polite society. She's the daughter of a naval captain, the niece of Chief Justice Mansfield, but also the daughter of an enslaved woman who is nameless. And so she's an anonymous woman, and she's also a body of evidence. And the artist that represents her in a double portrait with somebody who was technically her cousin points this out by having her point to her own skin. So inevitably, thinking about what it means to be as a body in space and out of context brought me to a series of photographs that I adore and which have kind of stayed with me as a visual meditation, called Roaming by Carrie Mae Weems, which she produced during and after a trip to Europe, a two-year trip to Europe, and specifically in Rome, from sort of 2004 to 2006. And there are many photographs of a black woman in a black dress facing architectural monuments of power. And she's standing in front of the Uffizi, she's standing in front of the Louvre in Paris, and sort of challenging these spaces with just the physical presence of her body, but also challenging us as a viewer because she refuses to be seen, to be represented, to show her face. She resists representation. And here she's kind of facing, she's facing the sea in Rome, and we've heard already that the sea is this space of encounter, departures, arrivals, memory, pain, etc. It's a powerful metaphor for so many communities. So, when I stand here, when you stand here, when we all stand in space, who do we really come with? Called Bread by the artist, a British artist, Laura Mvula. And it's a very beautiful song that I urge you to listen to. But the text, "Lay the breadcrumbs down so we can find our way," makes me think of the process that many people in different parts of the African diaspora are going through in trying to reconstruct their identity, trying to find their way through fragments, whether it is through spiritual practices, whether it is through the archive itself, through images, through the things that our parents have given us as residue, as what is left over from the journeys they have also taken. So these are my two parents. I show them here because I don't regularly put them up, but I think they're pretty amazing, and also because they're about to celebrate their 40th wedding anniversary. And my mother would love me to tell people that, you know, she was dressed in blue and not white, and they're still together. So she was like, white dress, a myth. They were both, and still are, both creative people, both artists. But they were here in cold London. They hadn't been in London at this point for more than about a year, becoming new citizens of this place that then became my place of birth. So what did I inherit from them? Of course, I inherited from them everything that they shared, everything that they taught me, how I was raised, the cultural context. But having spent a couple of years working with geneticists and bioarchaeologists in Copenhagen, which is even the reason why I'm here, actually, it got me thinking about standing in place and carrying with you an entire army of people that are invisible. From the spiritual tradition that I come from, of course, we walk with our ancestors, but actually geneticists helped me to think about those ancestors that I didn't even have a kind of conceptual frame for, the people without names, without voice, and the people in between that are sort of like the unknowns that are branches of your mitochondrial and Y DNA. So when I stand in this space, and when we all stand in this space, whatever our spiritual inclination is, ultimately we don't stand alone. We stand as the kind of biological product of a story, a narrative. And so thinking about what is carried and also what is absent leads me to artworks like this one from the Bahamanian artist Lillian Blades, which stands in Atlanta Airport. So it stands in a passageway of departures and arrivals. And Lillian Blades provides these empty white dresses for people to occupy, but also frames of reference. And we can put ourselves there, our ancestors there, and she also invokes women to occupy these spaces, though they do not have faces or names. I go back to my mother and her early attempts to decolonize by producing dolls that were black in the early 90s, but also producing dolls that attempted, that allowed her to return to the various cultural traditions all over Africa. So she researched and she was like, oh, what do the Maasai look like? And then she would try to reconstruct their images, their bodies, through these dolls. And dolls and quilt making and stitching and pulling things together, these are all preoccupations of the work of many diaspora artists, particularly women, such as Faith Ringgold. And I like to think about this process of mark making, of stitching, as a way to put our mark in time. So these are gestures that say we were here. And this is a very particular memory of a time in the 60s when Faith Ringgold and her sister and her nieces took a trip on the SS Liberté to Paris. We can imagine what that experience might have been like. And so to memorialize them dancing in the Louvre is a very special and counteractive act to what we expect people to do in a museum context. You're just talking about holding dances, right, in museum spaces. Well, she imagines them dancing, celebrating in the Louvre and in front of the Mona Lisa, which technically would never happen because there'd be too many tourists all like doing this and taking selfies, but such is. So, what do we capture? What do we hold? How do we maintain the odor of the dead? How do we keep them with us in order to stand as community rather than alone? I won't read these words, but I just put them up to add to the energy of the conversation. And so too also with the artwork of the Cuban artist Maria Magdalena Campos Pons. This work is also about all of those mothers that migrated north from Cuba to make money, often leaving their own children behind. So what do you give them in the absence of the matriarch? And she constructs this boat in which the mother's milk is reposited. So as somebody who has spent a long time working in a very deep archive, the 18th century archive of slavery, but now also in 19th and early 20th century colonial archives here in Scandinavia, I can approach this process as a kind of traditional art historian, or I can begin to think about how to really attend to the dead as spirit work. So this is work in which I recognize that everybody involved in the production of this artifact has agency, has voice. And so I show you a snippet. Let's see if that works. Oh, let's go back. There we go. Of Janetta Eller's work. She's here in the room, so hey. Of Double Me. Yes, very early work. She's always so embarrassed. And I'm like, no, this is it. So you can speak to Janetta and also go to her website if you want to see more of the artwork. But she may not know that I've been talking about this work a lot in relation to just the construction of memory, how we enter the past, what happens when we return to the site of memory, how we slightly alter it and change it as we kind of attempt to insert ourselves in the historical narrative. This is a piece of footage of Janetta as a child in which she has kind of cut her modern self. And anyway, she'll talk about her remediation practices. But just for me, what's very powerful is a sort of is the edges around the modern Janetta, because for me, this is the space I occupy as the historian. You know, entering the archive, but somehow infecting it and shifting it and changing it, and also this practice of repetition and the sound, which is the sound that the Danish videographers kind of just put on the footage when her parents had it converted. You know, so somebody else's notion of what nostalgia and memory sounds like. So all of these elements come and combine in this doubling, this conversation with history. I've been very inspired by the work of Saida Hartman, who has also spent a lot of time in the very same archive in which I operate, and asked questions about, you know, why when we enter this archive and we find all of these traumatic documents, why should we subject the dead to a second order of violence? And this is a really powerful question to ask, particularly in relation to the archives we've been talking about so far, ethnographic archives, because we are exposing the dead to new inquiries. And this doesn't just mean our academic inquiry or even the curating, but also what is happening in the process of digitization, which for me is the bit that is the scariest bit. What happens when all of this data reaches the Creative Commons and it is completely out of institutional control? How much care then takes place around these artifacts? So, are they words, are they bridges to the dead, or are we simply re-traumatizing not just our ancestors, but also ourselves in the process? I just wanted to show you a slide of some of the texts that I'm reading, because I wanted to emphasize, if there's anything else you take away from what I'm saying today, that for me, a decolonial perspective is one that is holistic and all-encompassing, and it is not just about reading academic text. It is about listening to music. It is about human interaction. It is about self-care, literal self-care, and thinking about how we engage with one another. It is about mindfulness and empathy and compassion and all those beautiful words which people abstract into religious or spiritual context, but which are actually integrated in the concept of care that I read from Uzma's work. So all of these books are on my shelf. I'm currently at the very minute reading The Sovereignty of Quiet by Kevin Kwashi, which is such a powerful book, which is, you know, saying actually quietness, that is not silence, but quietness has its own quality, that sentience, that inner life of black people. actually is revolutionary and transformative. So this is for me a decolonial reading list. But in the context of archiving and museums and cultural heritage, I kind of take quite strongly from the Africanist decolonial discussion, particularly the work of Ngugi wa Thiong'o and other writers, and this notion of dismemberment. So I am literally trying to explore tactics for, as Ngugi says, remembering the fragmented. And so for me, decolonizing is about addressing all the ways in which conditions of coloniality have created conditions of separation. That is separation of people from language, that is separation of people from their very sense of being, because how they are referenced in the notion of the human family is always as the underling or or less than. And then, of course, the territorial cutting up of the continent, which literally inscribed very painful lines, often across linguistic and tribal groups that didn't, you know, co-sign to the same notions of what it means to live across territories. And then the physical dismemberment that we still have troubles looking at. I mean, the beheading was a strong metaphor from this morning, but also the cutting up of limbs and other things that we will probably evoke in our imaginations when we think about the colonial archive. So for me, the project, the decolonial project in personal practice, in the body, in the mind, in the spirit, but also in terms of our professional practice, is about this quest for wholeness. I mean, ontological density, blah, 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 but it's basically the I am-ness, the sense of being, of whole, and that is a great work. It's the life's work. It might not end. It certainly won't end with us, and it may not even end for the next few generations. But this is the bigger project. It's also addressing the ways in which, as Aimé Césaire points out, the ways in which colonization has also influenced the colonizer. So it is not just about colonized peoples, you know, working through their pain, both in public and also in private, but also thinking about the way in which spaces of privilege are also haunted by this memory. And this, I think, is actually the work that people are sort of reluctant and uncomfortable to do, but it has to happen, right? It's not just us. Literally, it's just not just us. Okay, this is a document from, you know, an 18th century text about human anatomy and variety. This is dismemberment. This is actually the thumb and a piece of breast flesh of an African woman in an attempt to, you know, that 18th century moment of, okay, where does blackness come from? Is it about the sun, or is it about some strange ink that is underneath the skin? What is it? I mean, we have to remember that the Enlightenment project was like haphazard. It was all guesswork. There was no genetics, so everyone was just figuring out what the heck makes us different. Why is he brown and I'm white? But of course, used then to propagate another powerful agenda. So this is dismemberment, one kind. But then there's also all the fragmented images and orphaned images, I call them, orphaned images and people with no names and no cultural context and no citations that I am finding every single day in my professional practice. What to do, how to bring them to a sense of wholeness when I don't even know. And also, this has been part of a conversation we recently had at a conference called Black Portraitures in South Africa. You know, why is it that we only care about these individuals at the point of their death, right? Why is it that we now give them reverence because they are in the walls of an institution? Would we have cared about them when they were living, right? And this is a question for all of us to answer, and which may be quite difficult to answer when we think about it in relationship to how we deal with the living beings that are crossing territories in the same way that these historical beings also did, as outsiders, as aliens, as foreigners, as people who don't speak the same language. So what would care, curation look like? I mean, when I think about care, I'm thinking about curation, the traditional notion of the word, okay, to look after, to attend to be a guardian for. Just tell me when you think I need to stop and I will. What does it look like? In the sort of several West African traditions, but one that is very potent for many communities in the diaspora about forgetting the dismembered, we always draw on the Akan philosophy of Sankofa, which is the symbol, the Adinkra symbol, is a bird facing forward but reaching for an egg behind it. And so it is the idea that you go back and fetch it. You go back and fetch history, but in order to move forwards. It sounds simple, but actually when you think about it deeply and philosophically, it's something that it can be very challenging to do. So I've been really looking at archival documents with care. So what does it mean in practice? It means that when I look at this woman who for a long time had no name in the National Museum in Denmark, I thought about the idea of the archive not even referencing her name. Describing the fact that the child who's European that she holds is from the Lackman family, which was a family that owned a plantation in St. Croix, a sugar plantation, which was very profitable. And that we know this because one of her descendants, who is a teacher, it says so bottom, sort of verified this point. So the baby, which is even disappearing in this particular reproduction of the photographic negative, is the point of focus. And the woman who is clearly very present and is offering her subjectivity is not mentioned. But then the archive is kind of confused because at first it was noted as a family portrait, and then that scratched out and it becomes household. So there is this disruption somewhere someone says, oh, is this family? No, it's more household. Is this a way to recognize this woman? Then when I actually really looked closely, I realized that not only is this woman looking down, and so she is resisting representation either out of because she has to or because of the moment of the photograph, or because she recognizes that she is actually there to support the child in the long exposure of original photography. I then also recognized that her face was heavily scarred. So what kind of memories, what kind of biography does that then tell us about what this woman experienced? I then also looked at the way in which there were intimacies emerging from the photograph, the way in which their two hands touch, knowing that African nannies, black nannies, were part of the rearing and the caring of European children in a West Indian context. So what would it take, what kind of inner life would it take for a black woman in the Virgin Islands in 1910, 1912, to look after a white child from a position of subservience and still give that child care and love and attention, and possibly even recognize that she is not the subject of this photograph? This is the deep looking that I think is required for each and every single artifact. And this is why it's exhausting work, because nobody wants to look through literally hundreds of thousands of photographs and do this. But I kind of think this is what is required, you know, on a curatorial level, at least some aspect of our practice. As part of my collaborative work with my colleagues in the Living Archives Research Project, I've been also doing some kind of mini performances to think about what kind of gestures I might be able to offer these silent subjects from a position of knowledge, from knowing the archive, from knowing the conditions, and knowing all the things that maybe other people would not. But it was actually quite challenging. For that particular woman, it was quite challenging. She proved very elusive as I tried to kind of find ways to connect with her body across pixels and projector light. But I did find out that her name is Aranitha James, and she did actually come to Copenhagen and then went back to St. Croix. And so with this name now, I might imagine alternative biographies for her. But in other contexts, I have...
Sorry to interrupt you, Tim.
Yes.
Can you tell us how you found out who she was?
Oh, I found out she was called Aranitha James because there is a historian called, thank you for that, a historian called Per Nielsen in Denmark, who's been doing some work on black people in Copenhagen. And he was working out who was employed on the Lachmann plantation and then figured out who she was. Although he has a slight question mark, but he pretty much figures out it's her. Yeah.
Thank you.
So this is just basic historical work. Yeah.
Okay,
we don't need
cameras
for this.
Rolling.
With some other photographs, also, again, more gestures offered, small things to find ways to engage with the dead. So one of the key questions that I'm asking myself as an art historian is what kind of art history could be written in this particular colonial context if we began with the needs of the subject to be seen or not to be seen. And that is a very radical thing because art historians are all about visuality and aesthetics and kind of like the right to look, right, in the words of Nicholas Mirzov. But what would happen if we decided, okay, let's just see what the artifact tells us through research. But let's see what the artifact tells us. Let's see if this person really did, in fact, want to be seen. Again, complicated, challenging, layered work. But of course, I am doing this with a whole kind of tradition of artists who have inserted themselves in the archive to offer gestures of reconciliation, but also of resistance, like the work of Ayana Jackson, or the work of the Colombian artist who inhabits the negrita, it's a kind of colonial trope on everything from, you know, rum to chocolate. Not just in Colombia, in other parts of South America, Liliana Angulo Cortez. This is a prominent artifact from the 19th century of the Khoisan woman, Sarah Bartman. And she was exhibited in London and Paris as, you know, as a human curiosity. This is a satire, you know, sort of mocking the people that came to see her. I'll move forward. This is the moment at which I'm assuming that you all know this story. So just Google because there isn't time, but it's very deep. Sarah Bartman, after she died at the end of 1815, the beginning of 1816, her body parts were dissected and maintained in jars of formaldehyde at the Musée L'Homme in Paris. So, and this happened, they were on display until I think the 80s, and then in the 90s, of course with Nelson Mandela, came the movement to bring her remains back. So this is the moment, a body cast was also made of her physical being, and this cast along with the remains were eventually returned to South Africa and given a proper burial. But I use that to talk about also ways in which artists have inhabited these historical bodies to offer other critiques, other reflections, to queer these bodies also. This is Renee Cox in collaboration with Lyle Ashton Harris. And this is Senzi Maracella doing something that I am advocating for, covering Sarah in this linotype. So I can see these performances, my own as a researcher and those of artists, as ways to kind of participate literally in a proper dialogue with these artifacts. And this means that performance is a form of reenactment, of course, of substitution. So my body standing in, which is the original question that Gaylin was asking me, what do I stand in for? How do I carry history with me? Of transmission, of mounting, of revival, and so on. These are the ways in which various performances can be enacted. In the meantime, I listen to music to get me through this torturous work. Music for exile. I can't see it on the screen, which is why I'm reading it this way. Music for the preparations, the significations of departure, for the symptoms of migration, the languishing music. Music for your invisibility. Music for the day when you fall, when in fall or in autumn, when you buy a new coat and think perhaps you will live here for the rest of your life. I will live in Copenhagen for the rest of my life. No.
Mostrava esse caminho longe pra São Tomé. Quem mostrava esse caminho longe, esse caminho pra São Tomé. Saudade, 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 desse minha terra, San Inclán.
So that, of course, is the beautiful voice of Cesária Evora Sodaj. So I was going to talk about, because I actually prepared to sort of talk for a good hour, but never mind, because I want you to talk too. I was going to talk about performances of power and the weird shit that happens when your body is in, you know, modern space, i.e. in Scandinavia in 2016. I was going to talk about the weird encounters that I have in the supermarket and in various spaces. And as Uzma talked about this, I love the phrase of deep betrayal of artifacts of pleasure. Well, they're in the supermarket now. These are artifacts of pleasure, the cocoa, and then there's the man from the Middle East who's on the vanilla packaging. All these, you know, let's move on. But I must show you the words of Grada Quilomba, another scholar based in Berlin. Her definition of everyday racism, actually her definition of racism is powerful, and I think it should be taught and kept, so this is why it's here. But this idea of racism not being a single assault, or a discrete event, but rather a constellation of life experiences, like the encounters I was going to talk about, a constant exposure to danger, a continuing pattern of abuse that repeats itself incessantly throughout one's biography, in the bus, at the supermarket, at a party, at a dinner, and even in the family. I mean, this is the kind of saturated nature of not just racism, but the very conditions of coloniality that we live with. This is why it is personal work as well as institutional or intellectual work. In fact, that kind of comes last. It's really figuring out what is happening in our human relationships. So this actually is all I want to say on that matter. And maybe the sound will come slightly. Disruption, rapture. This is Camille Normand, who was the representative for the last Venice Biennial for Scandinavia. But yeah, we'll move on from that. But you can see her work. But I just wanted her presence to be here. So she says the body is a site where various forms of knowledge converge. This knowledge is a manifestation of the information that the body has gathered, consciously or unconsciously, in a reckoning with its sensory experiences, creating our sensory knowledge spaces. So we are all repositories of knowledge, and we resonate, we vibrate that knowledge. To end, before we discuss, I wanted to show a couple of art projects showing the ways in which a number of artists have kind of used the agency of presence, of just being there, but not necessarily communicating, to do some very powerful decolonial work. But I will just encourage you to actually look at a couple of these, because I want to end with a ceremony, actually, at the end. This is the work of Lorna Simpson, Corridor. She has these two spaces that she worked with in Massachusetts, this coffin house, and then the Bauhaus, Walter Gropius house. And she collaborated with the artist Wangechi Mutu to sort of perform in these spaces quietly, at the same time creating a very kind of abstract soundtrack across a century between the work of Blind Tom and Albert Ayers. But that video, I just urge you to watch online. It's called Corridor. I wanted to really get to the work of Sasha Huber, our sister she's a Haitian Swiss artist currently residing in Finland. She has been part of a wider project called Demounting Louis Agassiz, who was a glaciologist but also a proponent of scientific racism. She's been working with the Swiss historian Hans Fessler, who's also an activist, and he kind of gathered this group of amazing people together across continents to address this history. He's also the one that commissioned these photographs by Joseph Zeely, probably the earliest of daguerreotype, of the form of the daguerreotype itself, but also representations of enslaved people from West Central Africa. What is powerful is the fact that Agassiz has these traces literally all over the world. So all of these sites are named after Agassiz. And that includes a crater on Mars and the Moon, and a few species of animals. So what does it mean for the traces of this man to be so widely scattered, to literally colonize the universe in this way? And how might we undo some of that work? This is the question that Sasha has been involved with. She has been trying to unname, rename places. Renty was one of the elders in this group of enslaved people that was photographed, and so she went to Renty Horn. Well, she renamed it Renty Horn, so it's called Renty Horn in my eyes, in the Swiss Alps. She has also been to Brazil, where she has been telling people at the square named after Agassiz about the true history of this space. She has been inserting her body along with another reenactor next to Agassiz, who believed that people of mixed heritage were sort of like an abomination of nature and should not exist. So she is kind of resisting his own ideology, his own rhetoric through photography. The spaces that are named after him, she has been creating a sort of series of photographs in which she becomes the ethnographic subject. And lastly, recently in New Zealand, she worked with a local Maori community to find a way through their own words to remove this memory from one of the glaciers in New Zealand, and I'll end with that.
Pakatakata hei ki te uru, pakatakata hei ki te toka, kia mā kina kina te uta, kia mā taratara ki tā ehi ake te atakura, he tio he huka, e hauhu, ti hei Māori ora. Hauru o taku waka, ho raka hautu taku takata, ho tūtoko taku mauka tīpuna, ho makawhia te awa, ho aute te toka, ho kati mahaki te hapū, ho pauteni kaitahu te iwi, ti hei Māori ora. Etuarahoi, Kedaro, Iti, Tomaramara, Otakumoka, Ariki, Etitine Kiteraki, Mina Mokoto Katoa, Mofano, Ho Tiri Tiri Ote Moana, Te Tahuhu, Ote Waiponomu. Tukua e nei moka, nā araki nui e tūnei, i ngā waho mua. Mauri a mai mātou, ngā koroai, o Rangi Mārie, ke te horaina atu, ke runga i a koutou katoa. Tukua te wairua ke rea i ngā taumata, Hai arahi o tātou mahi, tā tātou whai i ngā tikanga o rātou mā, kia mau, kia ita, kia pupuri, kia tina tina hui e tāiki e.
Questions or comments or observations for Tammy? Sara?
Thanks, Tammy. That was a real privilege. I love the sort of praise song structure of your presentation, and I was struck by the absence of sort of people within the formal academy. And that, you know, I sort of narcissistically keep returning to the kind of formal museum sector that I know. And I wondered if there were, there were any people who might not appear in that presentation, but who, from the formal museum and gallery world, that you walk in their steps and in the practice that you're doing now, or is your practice so self-developed and new and sort of self-curated?
Yeah, I mean, I always say that I stand, you know, being brought up in Britain, there has been a long-standing historical struggle for equalities, not just in life, but also in culture. And so I definitely, in terms of just trying to bring what is hidden to light, I definitely stand at the shoulders of community groups and activists and people like Every Generation and Positive Steps and institutions like the Black Cultural Archives and the Huntley Archives and the bookshops in Dalston and Harlesden and you know, all of these and commissions like the Mayor's Commission of African and Asian Heritage and all these initiatives, the WHO's Heritage Conference, you know, where Stuart Hall gave his wonderful speech that still is resounding in our ears in 2016. I mean, I definitely stand on the shoulders of a lot of work that has taken place. And as someone that has engaged with the Atlantic Worlds Gallery at the Maritime Museum and the work that's been done in Bristol and, you know, I mean, I could go on forever about the work that I kind of that is my foundation, but I do feel like there is another way now, you know. in response to, but also away from the institution. Because I think the institution just provides, even when I think about entering those spaces, you know, I'm doing a little collaborative project at the moment with two very big institutions in Denmark, the Royal Library and the National Gallery of Art. And I just like, it's like this, suddenly there's like, you know, permissions and forms, and all I want to do is just get, you know, new voices into this space, simple. And then I think I'll just hack it and just put the voices in by force. But then you think, no, because you want the institution to also shift. You want the staff to have new experiences and feel different things, and as a result, change the institutional culture when you are gone. Otherwise, these spaces won't decolonize. It just won't happen. So yes.
I thank you so much for very a lot of inspiration. Just a comment. I mean,
yeah, sure.
Institutions are actually acting still like in the enlightenment ages, actually.
Yeah.
While descendants of those colonized people are living here in the West, actually. So that's, there is a lot of work to do. Also, there are a lot of challenges to do, to experience. And that's the actually maybe healthy to be away from institutions. But on the other hand, that's the space to be, actually, to resist, actually. And there, you could work a lot, I think.
Yeah, that is definitely a paradox, you know, inside or outside. But, you know, I'm remembering some words that Carrie Mae Weems has been speaking recently about, just, you know, what can your body stand for in any particular context? Like, how can I be present in an institutional space and kind of move not just for Black people or people of color, but move for humanity? Like, how can my body do that? What can I offer to the institution for that compassion, that empathy to take place? And then I think if we as practitioners think about it in that way, then the institution is just one platform, but we can carry that across to the so-called public space, and to smaller organizations, and to our homes. I mean, bell hooks is always talking about what's happening in the home as well. It's like, this work has to happen at home first, almost. You know, institutions are kind of macro of the micro, right? So, but yes, it's a paradox which we will live with.
Sarath and Uzma and...
Thank you so much for that. There's so much there, and I'm so glad that our talks kind of like were one after the other, because there's a lot of synergy. This idea of being, right, of being is so important, and so much of like when I first started thinking about it, like whenever, I was really worried about falling into sort of the crunchy granola mindfulness trap.
Yeah.
Right. And because. I mean, I like granola, but that wasn't, because that mindfulness is a different kind of like presence, right? And so there has to be a very specific distinction that we're making in the being of just the fact that my body is here, that your body is here, and all our histories and all our ancestors and Gerald's bodies, like all of our bodies are here, actually transforms the institution, right, the being of those bodies. Not just the fact that we are aware that our bodies are here, but that we are aware of your body being here, right? So that mindfulness that the crunchy granolas took as becoming so self-involved and so self-centered and very much about the person and finding center, like centering yourself, is actually about centering us, right? And I think that's a very important distinction to kind of for us to keep in mind as we move forward. Like, not for, like, you and me, but, like, I'm thinking generally. Because sometimes when we say mindfulness, like, I think people automatically go there, and we think about presence, and we think about being, it becomes this sort of new age. But this being is about self. It's not self-care just of the individual, but it's self-care of the ancestors, of the many different generations, of the social relations between them. You know, and I think that is a very interesting thing. So the reason why I'm saying all of this is because I think it's so... I've been trying to reformulate methodology, not just for archaeology, but also for ethnography, which is hugely problematic as an anthropologist. And I hate... Let me rephrase this. I'm teaching my students no longer to say that they're going to the field, right? And I'm teaching my students to be very careful about thinking about what kinds of investments they're making. And in some sense, I'm teaching them how to be. Yeah. I'm saying, go live somewhere. You have to have a stake. If you're going to write about a community or if you're going to write about an issue, if you don't have a stake and you have nothing to lose and you're not precarious, then you are committing injustice. In that ethnography. And so I'm just wondering if you've thought through, like, because, and in some sense, like, this is what Sarah's asking, like, is this new? Like, we stand on the shoulders of many, but in some sense, it is kind of new. Like, I know you're being kind of humble. Like, this is actually, this is shit we're figuring out right now.
Oh, yeah,
like,
absolutely.
In conversation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like right now. You know, like, I'm thinking about this right now. And, you know, and I think that this is, it's very exciting.
Yeah.
Because I think the potential for transformation of so many disciplines, because this is transdisciplinary, is massive, right?
Yes.
And I always wondered, like, what could we possibly do to undiscipline our disciplines? And what I realized that all we had to do was share, you know? And that, just being transdisciplinary shifts so much. So my question to you is that in being, in your practice of being, of putting those images up, of opening your door, right, of being.
Yeah.
If I were to ask you to think of a methodological kind of just,
it.
I know, sorry. But like, if I were to say, here's some ways of being, even if it comes through stories.
Yeah.
Right? What might you, how might you respond to that?
Wow.
And I know, because we are literally doing this right here.
Yeah. But it's a good thought to okay. Yeah, can I think about it and then take another question and then sort of crunch it? Yeah.
Sarah has a question. I'd like to ask something sort of
Yeah,
Sarah,
keep
this, right?
Yeah.
No, that's fine.
Gerald? Yeah.
Go
no?
for it.
Okay.
While you're thinking, I mean, this is related, so probably this is like a much easier question, but so you can just probably knock it out while you're thinking the hard one in the back, which is about sort of identity politics and how that's being framed in the kind of current political moment. There's been a lot of talk about white lash as a response to the rise of identity politics, and a lot of sort of what you've been talking about this morning, kind of stuff I'm doing, around activism in the sector. It centres on what a lot of people will read as identity politics. You're building solidarity with queer workers or women and black workers.
Yeah.
So, and it's effective, but I haven't yet found a language to explain it to people which kind of gets me out of the identity politics ghetto other than sort of solidarity.
Yeah.
And then sometimes policymakers who love a lot of the things that are going on because it's the kind of thing they're been trying to do for years, or get black leadership networks going or whatever, and it's sort of becoming grassroots and that's working much better. But sometimes policymakers say, "Oh, but hold on, what you're doing is effective, but the policy that we're writing at the moment is called the Creative Case for Diversity." And in that, we are kind of going away from identity politics. So is there another way to talk about this that isn't like identity politics? Because otherwise that sounds a bit backwards and we don't want to say that. But clearly you're getting shit done, so we want to claim it and we kind of want a language to be able to claim it with.
Oh, you want me to taxonomize this now?
No, no.
You want me to give this a language
you don't have to.
For the
but
sector?
Just, you know, but I'm sure you don't talk about identity politics.
I doubt,
I'd be surprised if that's a language that you use.
Not anymore.
Yeah. And I don't, in that I've been kind of taught not to, but I know that actually what I'm doing is about the solidarity of identity and shared identity, and that's why it's working. It's so I kind of need to rebrand it politically or something.
This is why the dismantling thing is so necessary right now, because we're kind of stuck with these neoliberal, lefty hauntings, which were useful at a moment and a particular moment in time. This cultural diversity dialogue was necessary, particularly in Britain in the 90s. But now, maybe it's necessary now, but people, this is what you were all saying yesterday, that like museums are like, oh yeah, well, we've done that diversity thing. And we have a few more brown faces. Oh, and we bought some art. And we just kind of know how to do community dialogue and how to get people in. And oh, we'll throw an interesting jamboree when we want to get a few more brown people. We're doing this, right? Yeah, you see, I'm not very good with institutional speak. It kind of gets me. But I think what we can be talking about is maybe, oh God. I mean, I think we should be talking about, I'm interested in building resilient, open-minded, empathetic human beings for the next generation when I'm gone, period. Like, so this is the language I have to, I'm using the archive, I'm using the Arts of Diaspora as one tool, but I also do it in other ways. I do actually teach mindfulness and other things, but I think we just have to find a language for what it means to be human in 2020 or 2030. You know, it's a futurist project, right? But very much situated in the crisis of now and why it's just not working. This isn't working anymore. And I don't have words for that, unfortunately. I really wish I did. Because then we could all get funding to do it. But I don't. And I'm still thinking about your... But maybe one more question. No?
I'm just aware that all of our colleagues are standing downstairs.
Oh, wanting to have lunch? No, I can't. Yeah.
For lunch. So if it's okay, Gerald, I'd like to prevent everybody else from standing in the cold outside while they're waiting on our...
No, it's all about love. It's all about love. Bring them in.
And of course, we have a closing remarks session.
Yeah.
Afterwards, that we will just open out into something else. Cool. So as opposed to having some closing remarks shit.
Yes.
So I have some ideas about how we can sort of maybe mobilise that.
Cool.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.